Hey, hey, mic check 1, 2, 1, 2. Yes. How's everybody doing out there at internet land? Welcome to another installment of That's My Story. If this is your first time joining us, That's My Story is the hottest internet sensation where we invite on some of your favorite musician, artists, engineers, producers, actors, comedians, whatever their field of expertise happens to be. And we take a walk down memory lane with them and we celebrate while we educate. Allow me to introduce to you my co-host at the bottom of your screen. Ladies first, we refer to her as our triple threat. She is a phenomenal singer, dancer, and actress. She represents the iCats as well as the Honeycomb. She is also the spouse of Mr. Verdeen White, an incredible bassist, as well as co-founder of Earth, Wind, and Fire. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Miss Shelly Clark White.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Hey, guys. Shelly.
Yes, right. Yes, y'all. Yes.
The queen. Also,
the queen. Yes. And also joining me, He's from Detroit, but he lives down south in South Carolina with me now. But he's an awesome musician, specifically the saxophone. He produces, he arranges, he writes. He's also a king of Carolina beach music, and he's a member of the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Mr. Ken Knox.
Ken, sir.
All right. Excited, guys. So look.
Yes.
The guy with the plaid shirt on, he's a heck of a keyboardist, an extraordinary gentleman. Mm. He's also the musical director for Chairmen of the board. Mm. Does a great job in and out 24/7 365 when we were out there. But give a big shout out to Mr. Jerry Midas Hardison.
Midas,
thank you so much. I appreciate it. We want to welcome everyone to the show. Please come on in and drop a comment. Let us know where you are watching from. We like to know how far our reach is extending from week to week. And, you know, it's old hat by now, but we also like to remind you guys that if you are viewing the program over on Facebook, due to some of our content, sometimes you might get blacked out or you may get booted off the program. But if that happens, there's no need to worry, no need to panic. Just simply go over to our YouTube page, and there is the link right there. You have it. And while you're over there, hit like, hit subscribe, and hit the bell so you can get the notifications anytime any new content drops. And we appreciate you guys.
Yes.
Right. Indeed. All right. And as also customary here at That's My Story, we do a toast before we proceed. So we got episode 38, guys. I'd like to give a toast to a good show, good vibes, and good health.
Yes.
Yeah, if you're at home, you can raise your glasses with us.
All right.
And real quick before we proceed, I forgot to say happy birthday to my mom on last week's show. Her birthday was actually Saturday, so I gotta say happy belated birthday to my mom, my biggest supporter. Hey, mom, my biggest supporter in everything that I do.
Happy birthday, mom.
Yes,
happy birthday, Miss Hardison.
Yes, indeed. She's always here, always usually the first one in the room. So we appreciate you, mom.
Always.
All right. Well, we got a lot to get into tonight, folks. So we're not gonna prolong the time. So we're gonna get right into it. If you guys are ready,
you're ready.
All right.
Ready.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, tonight's guests are members of a celebrated R&B vocal group, R&B soul vocal group. They blend together incredible harmonies with well-polished dance steps. This group originated in the 1960s, and their work and their music have stood the test of time. They gave us hits and graced the charts with songs like Showtime, Do Me Right, Feel the Need in Me, You Want It, You Got It, and among many others. Tonight we are joined by Mr. James Mitchell, Mr. Dwayne Locke Lomax, Mr. Eddie Cameron, and Mr. Lavelle Jackson, and together they make up James Mitchell's Detroit Emeralds. The legacy continues. Please make some noise along with this.
The legacy continues.
Hi.
Yes. Hey.
Welcome to the show, everyone.
Good to be here.
Yeah, this is our first time.
Lavelle got his.
He got his.
Oh, okay, Lavelle. Yeah, we can still raise him up.
That's right.
We can still raise him up.
Oh, yeah.
How you guys doing today? Thank you so much for joining us.
Good. Good.
Fantastic.
Doing great.
Fantastic. This is the first time we've had as many members on the screen. So we're all a little on edge and we're going to make it do what it do tonight, as they say.
Do what it do.
Yes, sir. So our platform here, that's my story. It basically started due to the pandemic and us as musicians having to be quarantined. So we like to ask our guests before we get into the show, what have you guys been up to occupy your time while we've been not able to perform and not be able to be on stage and things of that nature?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Can y'all hear me?
Hey, yes. I'll go first. Hey, the elder statement will go first. Go ahead. Doesn't hurt anything.
Hey, yes.
So, at this age, you fall kind of early. So the elder statement will go. Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Yeah. So right. I'm James. And I'd say that last living original member, but hey, the group goes on. The legacy lives on. And we're so glad to have that happening. What I've been doing is I coach high school basketball. I'm a minister, and I have ears and heart open to everyone that's ever heard of music or played it. I enjoy it. And so I just enjoy living loud and loud.
All right.
Enjoying it.
All right. What about the rest of you guys? How do the rest of you guys been keeping busy during the pandemic?
I'll go.
Go, Lavelle.
Yeah. So, you know, working with the Detroit Emeralds has been great during this pandemic because, you know, we've been trying to stay active. We keep PSAs going, you know, for Mother's Day, Father's Day, holidays. And so, you know, we've been really active. We've also done a virtual video, Feel the Need Virtual. We put that together. And so we try to keep the name relevant that way. And some of us have our own solo projects that we're doing.
Awesome.
I have a home. I do videos here. I try to stay busy as much as I can. Plus, I teach. You guys saw that the other day. So.
Yes, yesterday. Yeah, that's great, man.
So, we're staying active and trying to stay relevant with that. And just trying to keep the legacy alive.
Indeed. What about you, Locke? How you been keeping busy during the pandemic, being off stage?
Oh, man. I keep busy loving the Lord, first of all.
Got it.
My wife and my grandson and family, and also you can see over here to the side that I got a studio here, so I'm in the studio and working things there. I keep busy, you know, doing the stuff that I need to do.
Indeed. And last but not least, Mr. Ecam, what have you been up to during the pandemic?
Well, during the pandemic, I pretty much just been, I'm a remodeler. I you know, pretty much build as well as, you know, houses. And I've just been, you know, like I said, you know, I lay carpet and plumbing. I pretty much do, you know, I'm a very outrageous person when it comes to just keeping myself busy. And I just try to just keep myself, you know, finding things to do during this pandemic. Most of all, just staying prayed up and hoping that, you know, this here pretty much will just go away. We know it's going to take time.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, like I said, I've just been busy. You know, someone calls me. I've been doing remodeling since 1998.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, multi-talented. All right. That's great. That's great. You guys, that's
we awesome. need you here.
Yeah. You got to take a flight out in the morning.
Hey, good help is hard to find. I'm telling
That's a fact. That's a fact. Well, guys, we're gonna take a few minutes with James here and go back to the beginning, and then we're gonna, you know, catch up to current day.
Good.
So James, where were you born and raised?
Well, I was born in Florida, Perry, Florida, a little town about 19 miles or 20 some miles from Tallahassee.
Okay.
But I was raised in Detroit from 4 years old and until now, and still here. Love Detroit.
All right. And tell us a little bit about your upbringing and your parents and siblings, things like that.
Oh, yeah. Well, my mom and my dad were one of those parents that believed in supporting supporting their children. And so they're the ones that got me into Detroit Emeralds or whatever to do. To say it all, at the beginning, we came to Detroit and stayed with some relatives, and they used to take myself and just my other brother, and we became eight of us, like the different six, see, it was quite a few of us, but just the two of us were in the beginning. And one day they took us to the Paradise Theater, which is now, I think, called the Orchestra Hall here, and to see a stage show there. That's where the people of color used to perform at. Because in Detroit, we couldn't perform in all the rest of them. But you have people like Ray Charles, Peg Leg Maiden, and Margaret. Different people would come in and we'd go see them. And the first time they took us in, we seen a young man up on stage. And he was playing for the Queen, Bingman. And we playing for the Queen, and he was playing piano. They call it Boogie Woogie Piano, right? His name was Sugar Child. I seen that guy, and it just opened the doors and told my mom them that's what I wanted to do. And from that day on, everything they could do to help that happen, they did.
Yeah, now, your parents had had an establishment at the time. Well, did your parents have an establishment at the time?
My mom and dad were. Yeah, yes. At that time, when we first came in, they were building up trying to own a business. So they would do different things to get active in the community. Like my dad was a great guy on creating different things. Like he used to call him Mr. Snowball Man because he made the ice cone machines and whatever like that. And that went from that to them owning a restaurant. And beautiful. I think you have a picture of one of the restaurants where they had Little Mitch's Luncheonette.
Hold on, it's coming up.
Of those guys. Let's see
that. Can we get there? We go. Little Mitch's Luncheonette. So that's you and your brothers right there.
Yeah. Believe it or not, if we speak on that, there's some things that came up that you would know about that got me into learning how to handle business.
Mm-hmm.
Because at that and working at it, my dad used to make me have a Sunday that I had to run the place, and I was only maybe about nine or ten. Wow. So I had had people working under me. So it was an experience.
Yeah,
I was getting ready to be a Detroit Emerald.
Yeah, and the key thing you said there was that your parents supported you, and I think that's evident, being that they gave you guys even an opportunity to perform at their establishment. I think that's wonderful.
Dad, from that particular, they went into buying, bought a skating ring and all different things, so we could perform whether we went out to perform to someone else.
Entrepreneurs,
and those things made us very popular. Yeah. And entrepreneurship got things going.
Yes, right. Indeed. Yes, indeed. That's awesome.
So, James, I'm like you, man. My inspirations were like Junior Walker, because I had the love for saxophone, you know, and Temptations, because as you know in Detroit, you know, you singing on the street corners and this and that. But I want to ask you, when you were at Persian, did you have a group, a band?
Yeah. Well, early I was in a group before Motown ever got started. It was called the Five Rockets. And we were pretty well known around, because what we used to do is, that's why
there you go.
Record hops. Awesome.
Is that you the second from the left?
Second from the left there.
The left, okay.
The bass singer was right behind me. And some of the guys that were in there, some with other groups that had some records, and I can't call the name of the groups right now, but they were in other groups that were pretty big, like the Diablos, and the groups were back in that time. As we broke up, and I became one of the Detroit Emeralds, or Detroit Emeralds. They went with other groups like Nolan Strong and Diablos, or a different acts that were happening there.
Right. Awesome. So your high school was Pershing, who?
Yes.
I think did the Four Tops go to that school? Levi and
well, hey, well, I know yeah, Duke, hey, not only Four Tops, Enchantment, Four Tops, the Dramatics, we say Detroit Emeralds. There are quite a few groups that went there. And what one of the things that I haven't mentioned that much about it, it will be in the book. I'm not plugging it, but the book, it'll be in the book. It talks about Eddie Floyd. It talks about Wilson Pickett.
Oh, Eddie Floyd.
All those guys used to rehearse. Yeah, they used to rehearse down the street in the cleaners before you get to Persian High School. And I walk by, see them in the back doing their routines. It was crazy, man. Crazy, but all those things. As a matter of fact, Joe Jackson, the Jackson 5's father, he played bass for them. And they come up, hey, we went by all these different things. And so eventually, guys like the Falcons, which they, that's where Eddie came from. Wilson Pickett came from the Falcons. A lot of them did. And so a lot of different things did. Well, they used to practice right down the street from Persian. As we walk past or go to the school, we went and see them and hurry up and get to school on time. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Now, when you were in school, you were
An athlete.
You were an athlete, right?
Hey, it was blessed. I mean, every guy I knew there in the neighborhood, they played every sport: basketball, football, hockey. We did it all. But at Pershing, I ran track and played basketball.
Wow.
Yeah. Nice. Oh, you do? Oh, man.
That's you.
Watch out. Hey, the little skinny dude on the end, man.
Number 19, oh, huh?
145 pounds, yeah.
Nice.
So,
that's nice.
Yeah. Right. During that time, I was 18 or 19 at that time, yes.
Wow. Well, that's pretty good, man, besides track. But I see there's a lot of talent that came out this school from the ones you mentioned.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, man, yes. Yes, it definitely was. One of the guys that played basketball with me was Lonnie Saunders. He's played with the Washington Redskins, played for Michigan State, was great for Michigan State. Then there was Joe Forrest, who became an airline pilot for Delta and Eastern. And all of us, we usually get together. Matter of fact, we were together yesterday after I spoke for the warm-up. I had about five things to do, but we all touched bases with each other and work with the youth and bringing them into the different professions that we're doing and talk to them about business, the different things to do to grow into who you should be, who you're going to be, and put those principles together, faith, family, what you do, whether it's schoolwork, sports, or whatever. Try to lead them in the right way.
That's right. Well, you made me laugh a minute ago when you said rehearsing in the cleaners, because I just found out yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
I just found out yesterday in an interview that one of my honeycomb girls used to from D.C., and she said they used to rehearse in an empty neighborhood swimming pool.
Oh, and, wow.
Right?
Oh,
right?
Oh, echo. Get the echo.
Right, yeah. Right. But can you tell
us great.
Can you tell us a little bit about how Detroit Emeralds got started? That's for any one of you.
Sure. Well, what's happening? We got started because of the Five Rockets, the group that I sung in.
Yes.
Wow.
The other two members of the group, which is the three of us, myself, James Mitchell Jr., Abram Tillman Jr., and Ivy Tillman. And what we did was, I was that little wild guy. My parents have let me do all things and sung with the different groups. We had gotten an offer to be at DJ Records, which was a big record label then for African Americans. Like they had Jimmy Reed, Precious, Jerry Butler, Dales. They had the different acts. Well, one of the acts they had was called Pee Wee Crayton. He was a blues singer.
Okay,
but he was one of those guys that had the slick back hair, looked good. Oh man! And he came in town to Detroit, and he did a show. Mm-hmm. And we were on the show. We had just became professionals, as they say, because we did a talent show. And if you won that, you could be a professional on the circuit that only the African-American acts could appear in. Uh-huh. There was a theaters around Detroit. And so he took us to Chicago, the five Rockets, but all the parents wouldn't let their sons go, and we missed that contract. And but the Five Rockets started it all, and the Tillman Brothers were a gospel group, and they used to sing against their manager would bring all of the top gospel shows into King Solomon Church here. And so the Staples Singers and all of them came in, but they used to battle with Bobby Womack and the Womack Brothers. So it was the Tillman Brothers going against them. When they came to town, Tillman Brothers ruled. When the Tillman Brothers went to Ohio, Bobby Womack them ruled, the Womack Brothers.
Right.
And it's a wonderful thing that through the years we got a chance to work together with them. But that's what happened. And even here, like with Smokey, them, all of us, everybody sung with different groups.
Mm-hmm.
At any time, I think Smokey took the serenade, him and Marv Johnson or whoever, and the other acts like this, Eddie Floyd and them, they're with the Falcons and Wilson Pickett. All of them did a place called the Greystone Ballroom and the Madison Ballroom. And those were places where we could go on skate, this is where all of us really got our cars going. The biggest theater here that we could do, we couldn't all the other theaters, but we could play the Paradise. They closed it down. We played in main theater on Hastings Street, which was like Broadway in New York. All African American, and they own everything. Reverend Franklin Church was on there, Aretha's speaking father.
I was going to say,
so we got a chance to do it. We went.
Okay, speaking of New York.
All right.
Get in there.
You want to jump ahead?
Go ahead.
You want to jump ahead a little? We got so much to cover. You all had success with a song called Showtime, and you had appearance at the Apollo.
That was our first tune that did great, and that took us in the Apollo for opening act.
Wow!
And there's some great acts on that show. Will you believe the parliaments? They had dues and everything. They weren't in what they got to be known as. Well, they got to be the psychedelics also. Yeah. So we had Apollo and one of the photos, I think it's my scene with it, or a little film on it. Scene in Detroit before Charlie Atkins got a hold of it.
Oh, Charlie. We worked Honeycomb worked with Charlie.
But, that was the guy. Charlie Atkins and Maurice King.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Well, we want to see a little video of
Showtime.
Here we go.
Showtime. All right.
A little video. Come on now.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I said that was before Charlie Atkins now.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so in 1970 you guys left Rick Tick and went to Westbound Records. and it seems like things really started to take off for
right,
you guys.
Right.
Could you tell our audience a little bit about the song title, Do Me Right?
Yeah, Do Me Right. Was written by Abe and myself for James Brown. Abe's wife and my wife and I, along with Abe and myself, went to Chicago to see James Brown show.
Uh-huh.
And when we got there, we just got the name of the Detroit Emeralds, right?
Uh-huh.
So he came off stage and we had a chance to talk to him. So we were a group and we wrote songs and everything. So he said, "Well, write a song for me and bring it to Cincinnati." So and so, I don't know if he thought we were gonna do it or not. And so, hey, we got back home. We didn't have a song. He said we started writing. Do me right. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And we wrote it all the way down to go to Cincinnati to meet him at King Recording Studio.
Uh-huh.
Finished it by the time we pulled up in the parking lot, right?
Uh-huh.
And they told us that Mr. Brown just left. He left before we got there.
Oh, man.
Wow.
We were so glad that we had a chance to go in the studio until we came back home and we kept thinking about this tune, right? So we had finished it, and that was the very first, our very first album, Do Me Right, the tune. And James Brown put us on, and he was over and act for his show. And he still, until the day he passed, anytime I see him, he'd say, "You boys gonna give me my percentage for writing." He said, "You know, that was my song."
Yeah. But it still worked out in your favor.
But that was a blessing for us to be able to do that, and we got in the business like that.
Indeed.
Yeah, right. It was. Really loved the tune, Do Me Right.
Yes. And you guys also had another song. Right,
it helped us.
A song titled "You Want It, You Got It."
Oh, hey, well, that came on the second album, "You Want It, You Got It." And it was just like Do Me Right. We just changed the beat on it and put the words in it, and it meant a lot to us. By that time, we were coming in Apollo. We got to be headlining acts. Get out of here. I didn't believe you. But we had went to the Apollo two times in between then, and the audience loved what we were doing. But by that time, we had got with Charlie Atkins, so we really knew what we were doing.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. I thought
I didn't say anything. That was someone else.
I got you. Okay. Well, we have a video clip of "You Want It, You Got It."
Yay!
And here we go with the Detroit Emeralds coming out of that Motor City with a thing.
You gotta be kidding.
Spider dog run pretty. Yeah. If you want it, just ask me, baby. You got it.
Yeah. Soul Train dances.
Oh, man.
They did fantastic with it. Thing with the Soul Train. With Soul Train, what they did was they recorded also Larry Graham doing Feel the Need, because Feel the Need was so big. And one time they put the Nimble's name on the hymn, and they played that. I like the fellow. It was hot. It was hot. But
yes,
the Soul Train dancers were out.
I'm the best dancers in the land.
Yes.
So, man, and the hits keep coming, James. Like Chairman of the Board, Honeycombs, and Detroit Emeralds, we all had great success in the UK. Mm-hmm. So, tell us about one of my favorite songs, "Feel the Need in Me." Tell us about that and why.
Feel the Need.
Yeah.
Well, we filled the need. What happened was we had other tunes. We were doing songs, and they start playing it over there, and they, we didn't know it was a hit. They had it on the album, but we didn't know that. And so they were playing it, and we were doing some American basses and all. And all the basses, the people on the bass could hardly get in because the general public was in there. In Germany, they were first been in. They were packing in there, and the things was that everyone in the building could sing all the lyrics and to fill the need in me. Wow. And so in England and Germany and Holland, they could all sing the lyrics. But as soon as we come off stage to shake hands, we'd say, well, how you doing? And they say, Frankenstein Deutsch. It would go crazy because they could sing every word, but they didn't even know
English. They didn't know English.
But it was, and it took off over there first, in Europe first. And by the time they brought it here, it was in, and I think we had that. There was another version of it here, and it did decent here. But then Tom Malden got a hold of.
Oh, Tom Malden, he's a friend of
mix on it. That bad.
In the UK.
Go ahead.
Yes, yeah, Tom Malden,
yeah.
I talk with him quite frequently. That's good.
Mm-hmm. Right, bro. Like, Tom was the guy doing that. Go ahead.
Yeah, and you're right. I'm great about Tom. Go ahead.
Okay. No. Well, Tom was one of the greatest mixers there, like they're doing now with all the stuff that's going. And he did a mix on Fill the Need. We had already went to the top of the charts. We knocked out the Rolling Stones, the Beatles. I think we were up as high as number four or better in it, in the top five. And so it was that. And Tom Malden came and mixed it again. They re-released and they went back to the top 10 or top.
Yeah.
It was amazing what that took us around the world.
So it looks like a lot of people covered Feel the Need in Me, like Graham Central Station, Brian Ferry, and Forrest. And so
one of the Bee Gees brothers had a big hit on it.
Oh yeah.
Nice.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah. Cool. Barry Gibbs had him. He had a big hit one.
That's awesome, man.
I'm trying to think. Leif Erikson was the big one that had the big hit on it. Right. And he was one of the teen idols. Leif Erikson. Yeah, he had a number one hit on it. So it was quite a few of them that did do it, Feel the Need.
All right. Well, here's the deal. We got it for you. We're going to play it for you right now. Feel the Need.
Oh, good idea.
Let's go.
Feel the need in me.
Feel the need in me. I don't need your love. Every day I need it. Every way I want it. Without your sweet, sweet love, I'd rather die. I need your love. I need it constantly. Go to me with apple pie. Just put your hand in mine. Love me all the time. To prove you will bang the scene. You make me what I need to be. Ooh, feel the need, oh feel the need in me.
Yes.
Feel the need in me.
That was a full orchestra.
A lot of fun.
I like that.
Yeah.
Great. So,
Edwin Starr was on that show also.
Oh,
okay. And I think it was called The Unforgettables. And so they brought it back, and it was a big show on the BBC, and it really worked out fine for us. Did a lot of great things for us to travel all over the world with that. Mm-hmm. With the Feel the Need and all the tunes that followed.
Mm-hmm. Well, great. In 1974, you and Marvin Willis started writing songs for another great group called The Floaters. That was a group your brother Paul, Paul in there? Okay. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, Paul was in there. Well, Float On was a my mom had told me over and over, it's good that you respect your parents and you do what they say. She was begging me to produce them because we had written and produced Sergeant Emeralds. And I said, yes, Mom, okay, so on. But this particular time, she said, I know it's a minute. And so we took them in the studio and we did a tune called So Glad I Took My Time. And it was a decent hit, and it went to number one round in Detroit and in Canada. And so it came up to whereas ABC Records was looking for an act to do it, and just so happened they heard that, and one of the popular DJs played some stuff from it, and we got an album deal for doing the tune, and the next thing we know, Float On was it. It was the last tune to be on the album. And what I wanted to do is wanted to have Marvin Gaye or Top did albums to where a tune took from one song to the other. It still was the Four Tops. And so that's what you hear. I've written that tune. Just woke up one morning before the session. I put it in my heart. I know he wrote it.
Yeah.
Excuse me to put it on paper and to put the music together. I got together that morning. Next thing we know, we were in the studio and we had every musician you can dream of to do it. The young men that are the blessed that played for the Detroit Emeralds on the road, and most of them now have become great musical directors for the Temptations. Arthur Marbury, Buster, which they call him, Brimstone Ingram, which was the musical director for Felipe Wynn. We had Kenny Goodman, who was last part, worked with Larry Cunningham before he passed, of the Floaters. He was there, and all those musicians, they let me use them. And then we brought in Jack Brokenshaw, all the guys that could really do it. Dennis Coffey, and they did the whole album. And they say, I know. We finished it, took the cassette with me on tour with the Detroit Emeralds. And I had it, the DJs played it, and I used to have to fight to get my cassette back. my security guy had to go get it. We left England, they were selling 1,600 a day.
Wow.
And next thing I know, we come here. It was crazy because they had started playing it in Texas. It took off then. What can I say? All I can say is float on. Because a critic said one time, he said, listen, he said, how can somebody write a song, say float on, and this tune could sell? He said, oh, yeah, I know, because the mailman visits the box and he can float on to the bank. And I knew he was telling the truth after they started saying
float on. And as we say in the
So
industry,
it doesn't make that much difference what it is.
And the checks keep coming.
It doesn't make that
much difference. Right? But right now, we want to
show anything about that. I'm just a poor little old man.
All right. We want to show a little of Float On.
Float On. Float to the bank.
Oh, that would be great. And then I
come with me, baby, to love land. Let me show you. I want you to float, float on. Come on, come on, come on. Float on, float on. Float on. Libra. And my name is Charles. Now I like a woman that's quiet. A woman who carries herself like Miss Universe. Take my hand, come with me, baby, to love.
Yeah, float on, float on.
Float on.
Yeah. All right.
That's a jam.
Yeah, you see someone said that. These are called the Little Temptations.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It was beautiful because I owned a bar. I owned a bar, and then what happened was these different talents came through. The Floaters came through. Chapter 8 came through. When Michael Henderson was a part of our family, which at the Apollo, he was a young man on, he was our musical director, and Eli Fontaine. Michael was our bandmate, and Eli Fontaine was our director in between Maurice King. So and we couldn't lose with the people that we work with. It was just a blessing to be with those people.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Well, you guys continue to travel and perform, and like with a group that is longstanding, you lose members along the way, whether it be natural causes or people just leave the group or whatnot. But you guys have been fortunate to replace and continue with a new legacy. So we wanna now bring into the conversation Lavelle, Dwayne, and Ekam, and tell the folks at home. I guess we'll start with you, Dwayne, Mr. Lott, and tell the folks at home how you became involved with the Detroit Emeralds.
I came involved with Detroit. I guess it had been at the time I was playing with the Detroit Chain 9 at the time. And we was rehearsing over here at this club called F Cocktail Lounge. And one day I was told we're going to play for the Detroit Emeralds, and I went in the rehearsal. That's where I met them at. And at the time, you know, I was and is saying at this particular moment. So I made it playing for them. And then from there, we happened to have carried on doing a bunch of other different things from there.
Yeah. And you had a stint with the chairman of the board at one point yourself too. I've come to know.
Yeah, that's right. Actually, that band that we were Chain 9, we were down south in Asheville, North Carolina, and Budget came down there and performed at a club. He had a different band, and it was just him. And we went to the club to see him, and Danny and Ken at that particular time to talk. Guess he must have told Ken, well, come on back, you know, we're gonna band together, we'll go back out to him. So Ken suggested to him me on drums, and then I get Danny and told him, okay, well, let's try him and see what he's all about. And Ken came and told me, and when he told me, I said, let's go. We got on the bus. It was either the bus or the train. I think it was the bus. We came back to Detroit, and from that point on, I was a part of chairman of the board.
Let me say this.
My first big gig.
Right. We took a lot to the UK, and he didn't even want to come back home.
No, he didn't want to come back.
No,
it's lovely over there.
But Lott is an extraordinary drummer. Whatever situation he was in,
he could drive
the group. You know what I'm saying? From his foundation of playing pocket. He was known for pocket, being a pocket drummer.
Pocket.
And when I told General and Danny about Lott, they said, man, bring him in. And Lott has played with Albert King, is it?
Okay.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay, Albert King. Tell us about the chance meeting you had with Bill Cosby.
Well, especially the other day, I used at the age of 4. This group around in Detroit called Mad Dog and the Pups. They were pretty big in Detroit. Their record never really hit it big outside of Detroit. But anyway, we were playing at this place called Phelps Lounge. Okay. And we were opening that. Give me a second. Flip it on back. We'll open that for their name there for a second. What is it, the group you used I can get turned. I'm sorry. Anyway.
Okay.
We would open it up for I can
turn. Oh, that's Shelly there, yeah.
And
how you not remember I
and then the audience. Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah. And we played, and in the audience that particular day, when Bill Cosby came up to me and like my drum playing, be back to Philadelphia and wanted to give me a career.
Oh, man.
Well, next morning he came to my house and he begged me to go back to Philadelphia. The management that for the group must beg my mother not to let me go.
Wow.
And she listened to them more than she listened to Bill Cosby.
Wow. That's wow. An interesting story. Yeah, that's awesome.
Thank him for that. And if I have a chance, yeah. If I ever get a chance to talk to him, I really him and remind him of that day because it kind of helped me on as a musician as well.
Indeed, indeed. All right. And what about you, Lavelle? Give us a little brief background of your musical history that led up to you joining the Detroit Emeralds.
Okay. Let me know now if my audio sound good because
you good. I think the way it's going in and out a little bit, but we maintain it.
Yeah.
Okay. I want you to hear every word.
Okay. That's right.
Well, you know.
That's Lavelle.
You must be a singer.
I came up, you know, playing a horn. I was a trombone player.
Okay.
And it's funny, you know, seeing Shelly, because one of my favorite bands was Earth, Wind, and Fire back in the day, still is.
Yeah, a lot of people say that.
And Andrew Wolfolk, that was my favorite horn player, play saxophone.
Oh, man. Andrew, yeah.
And Philip Bailey is my favorite singer of all time. Anyway, so singing in briefly, I sang with a couple bands. You know, we had some success. I worked with some production companies, and, you know, we had songs placed on some TV shows or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot, but a couple sitcoms. But that just got me to doing my solo projects, which led me to singing with the Dramatics meeting Locke and Mr. Brother Doom there. And that led me to now singing with the Detroit Emeralds. Short and sweet, Locke. You see how quick that was?
And clear.
You quit. Ben makes gotta joke each other. You gotta go.
They do this all the time. They do this all the time.
Oh, hey, that's part of being in a band.
That's right.
You gotta have thick skin because you're gonna get roasted and you're gonna roast back.
Oh, man.
So you best to have some good jokes if you're in a band. Best to have some good jokes.
Yeah, you're gonna get roasted.
I'm coming.
Gotta keep everybody off you. You know what I mean? What about you, E-Cam? Give us a little brief background of your musical history that led you up to this point with the Detroit Emeralds.
Well, as a young man, when it came to instruments, I started out playing alto sax, tenor sax.
Ah.
But as you know, as I was getting older, I found myself actually in choirs and so forth. And I was actually like always wanting to be on the stage. And as a matter of fact, my mother, she was a very inspiration in my life far as me wanting to sing. So I seen her, you know, and how she would be on the stage, and she'd open up shows for the Staple Singers and. And you know, her group, they did some traveling with the Impressions and so forth. So that was an inspiration.
Nice.
So basically, I found myself just wanting to be an entertainer. So I started at the age of 15 years old and started already doing clubs and traveling. But I find myself, though, like I said, you know, when it came to performing, because I am a performer. As well as an entertainer. And I basically feel like that, you know, when it comes to being on that stage and then I, you know, just doing all everything that I have to do now. How I actually got with the Detroit Emeralds, because I was actually traveling with the Dramatics here the last for 2 years, and I was just like on the standby, and for this particular show we had did, and I was just on the standby. Locke, he heard me sing. And he heard my voice.
Okay,
and so then Locke, he calls LaBelle, and at the time when the group was getting ready to, you know, to reform, I got a call from LaBelle, and LaBelle, he says, "Hey, man," he said, "how do you feel about being a Detroit Emerald?" I said, "What?" I said, "Are you serious?"
Wow.
I said, "Man, come on, man, let's do this."
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, you know what? You guys seem to mesh very well together.
Yeah. Cool. Let me tell you something funny.
Sure.
When Eddie, when I talked to Eddie, and we used to work together, and when we knew we were going to be in the Detroit Emeralds, you know, we were like, man, you know, I'm gonna just be honest with you. I didn't know a lot. I didn't think I knew a lot of Detroit Emerald songs at the time. And so we started Googling the songs, and I said, "Damn, I remember that song. I remember that song." Now we watch kids, so
yeah,
and we're at the place where we're working, singing all these Detroit Emerald songs, and we got kids running around us, and we had them singing. We had them singing "Do Me Right,"
yeah,
"As Long As You Got It." These are 4, 3, 4, and 5 year olds, and they're going around. No. "You want it, you got it." They're singing. Nice.
Because you guys were in the middle of learning the material.
Yeah, so yes. That was funny. So we were learning, and the kids were learning the songs. We had them stepping.
Repetition.
Yeah. I just want to go back briefly. You know, when I knew I wanted to sing, the first concert I went to. Well, not the first. The second concert I went to was when I knew this is what I wanted to do. I went to see Teddy Pendergrass, The Whispers, and Heatwave. When Teddy Pendergrass came on the stage, I think probably in less than a minute, he was soaking wet with sweat, and the ladies were screaming. And I thought to myself, I said, I want to do that. That looks like something that I would like to have happen to me. You know, they was throwing things on the stage. I forgot all about the singing part was not. I was like, these ladies screaming, that sounds like something I would like to happen, you know. But that was the first concert I went to that I realized I knew. The first concert I went to was B.B. King, Albert King, and Coco Taylor and Bobby Blue Band. And my dad gave me some tickets because my mom got sick and couldn't go. And I really didn't want to go because I thought they were a bunch of old people. When I went there, I was like, oh my gosh, I loved, you know, the music was great. I was really into it. That's when I got into blues. It was B.B. King, that one here. But that Teddy Pendergrass,
that did it for him,
that was it. I said, that's what I want to do. That reaction. That's what it was, the reaction.
Sure.
I had never seen that before. I watched TV and TV shows, but to see it live was amazing. Yeah. And then I saw the Whispers, and they were like, oh my gosh, they were great. Heatwave. But when Teddy came out,
it was a whole different
energy.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened in like a minute.
Right.
Wow.
Right.
I remember the song. He said, "Get down, get funky, get loose." He came out and he, that's what he did. He got down, he got funky, and he got loose. I see within 1 minute, he was soaking wet with sweat, and the ladies were just, I was sold then. I said, "Mama, oh, mama, that's what I want to do."
Wow, that's awesome. That's a great story.
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah. And speaking of meshing well, we want to show our audience a little clip of "Wear This Ring With Love."
All right.
Yes.
All right. Just wear this ring with love. This ring will tell the story. Think of all the good things we got to do. Children, a boy for
for me and a sweet little girl for you. How sweet it is for a man to love his woman. And baby, for a woman to love her man. Please
wear this ring with love.
Promise me, baby.
Forever.
I know you're gonna do it for me.
Forever.
Just wear this ring with love.
Hey. Oh, man.
Y'all sounding all yes. right there. Y'all sound like yes. a singing group.
Singing group, right? Right?
Yes,
they said E-Cam was one of the spinners.
been around.
You know what, man? Y'all, you guys have some strong voices, man. It's really, really refreshing to hear the new group do your own spin on the classic songs like that. Applause.
Thank you. Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. Legacy continues.
Yes.
Legacy continues.
Thank you.
Now, I know Locke put the group together, and then I think you guys come up with a, I think you guys wrote a new single called, what, Call Me, I'm Ready?
Yes.
Tell us about how that was, the story behind that. Locke?
Anyone.
Okay. All right. Actually, what happened with that particular song, I came up with a track that I've been working. And I sent it to Doom. And when I sent it to Doom, he said that, man, this is the... I'm sorry. After this call, I sent it to James Jr. I'm with the word that we use, because it's a funny word that we use. But then after he did on it, sent it to the very talented Mr. Lavelle Jack.
Oh, okay, the missing.
Did his thing on it.
Uh-huh.
And when they sent it. And when they sent it back to me, I was like, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
This is a smash. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah.
Well, listen.
Turn around, spin around it.
Okay.
Yeah, well, so Lavelle, your wife did something on the song as well? Is that what Locke is saying?
If anything, she inspired me, but no.
Okay. Oh, he must have said Mr. I thought he said Mrs. Okay. So he did the track and sent it to you.
Yeah.
Yeah, he sent the track to me. So,
okay.
So the track came to me and with Mr. Mitchell Dune's beginning little epilogue there at the beginning, and then he had the first verse and I listened to it and then I wrote the second verse, and then the song kind of developed from that point.
Awesome. Okay.
Well, we got a video.
Yeah, you know, we got a video.
Call me, I'm ready.
And share thoughts with you.
I'm ready.
Let me talk to you.
I'm ready.
I'm ready.
I'm ready.
I'm ready, ready, ready.
Oh.
I'm ready.
I wanna talk to you.
I made mistakes along the way. I can't live without you. No. These words I speak is coming from my heart. Oh, baby, dang, I'm ready.
what's on your mind? Are you ready for me?
Yeah, yeah,
yeah, buddy.
Yeah,
ready.
I just want to turn around, spin around,
spin a room.
That was great. Well, guys, in this pandemic, we're all working on being trying to be a little more creative and so forth. What new projects have you all been working on that you can share with our audience today?
Collectively or individually,
or both? Well, maybe collectively, and then maybe individually.
Okay.
Yeah. Look, yeah. I'll let Locke. So you can address okay. Collective, the Detroit Emeralds.
Okay. All right. We this subject you all know. We they wouldn't negotiate now. With a major label over in the UK. I can't mention the name right now of who okay. it is, but mm-hmm. this, and it should be soon that they will be being the song Victory, which coincide with, you know, this pandemic that we're in, that we're receiving a victory from it. And I believe the song is pertinent right now for where we are with this pandemic. So right. The two is entitled Victory.
Victory.
Awesome.
Nice.
Great.
Anybody else?
Well, just like Locke said, you know, we're working, we're actually working on several songs, but we have the next release is Victory. Mm-hmm. And as Locke said, because we're expecting to be victorious out of this pandemic.
So, absolutely. Not the end.
Yeah. So we're still working writing songs and producing and just trying to make it through.
Indeed. Well, indeed. We hope that when you can finally reveal this project that you let That's My Story know first.
Yes, please do.
All right.
Well,
yeah. Now it's time for the Shining Stars segment.
Oh, Shining Stars. Oh, my.
Yeah.
It's I need you. You are my shining star.
Well, you can wait on this, aren't
you? Okay. That's all I've been right, waiting on this. That's a way to introduce it, huh?
I'm
Now it's when the audience can ask you guys anything. So, audience, start typing.
Yeah, boy.
And we'll do our best to get. Okay.
Yay. Yeah.
Oh, Carlo. Not
UK.
Carlo Didcott.
Yes.
From the Hello UK. From the UK.
Hey, Ken, UK. I see our fellow bandmate, John Page III, is on today.
Uh-oh. Oh, nice. John Page.
Yeah, in the horn section. Shout out to John Page III. Rhonda Bedekian.
There's
cool.
our publicist,
Ron Siddiqui. Right. Can you tell
cool.
John Page I say hello?
Okay. Hey, John, Dwayne Locke said hello. There's Donna Isley Hill. Hi, folks. So excited about the Detroit Emeralds tonight.
Yeah, we are too.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, thank you.
Hey, I've got one. We have a call from Detroit. Michigan.
All right.
Okay.
Go ahead. Hold on. Here we go.
Who is
they
that?
Saying, hey, Dune. Is that somebody's nickname?
Is you, Dune?
How y'all doing? Hey, how you doing?
That's
how hey. You
good.
Hey. All good.
All right.
All right.
It's Kevin Carter from Detroit.
Kevin Carter?
Oh, hey.
Oh, man, Kevin Cotter.
Oh, AJ's fault. Yeah, Calhoun. Oh, man, that's the guy. Yeah, that's the guy. Yeah. Hey, good to hear from you, Cal.
All right.
Hey, awesome. I was a good time player. I was the original role for time player on the Clovers.
Oh. All right. Nice.
Oh, yeah. Nice. He did some great things, bro.
He also,
hi, Kevin.
He also had a cool Kevin thing. Also went to Northwestern High School together. Him and I went to Northwestern High School together.
Oh, you went to high school with him.
Okay.
Northwestern High School. Bro.
Yeah, Catherine Dakin says hi from Monroe, North Carolina. Love you guys.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Oh, hey, me.
Hey, Locke. Kevin Carter.
That's my mom. Dad. Hey, mom. Much love, mom. Love you. Thank you for tuning in.
Yep.
Hello,
guys. I know.
My mama.
Hey, she's my favorite girl.
Is there any questions, girl?
Yeah.
That's our North Carolina Music Hall of Fame chairwoman there.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Folks at home, get your questions in.
From Chicago.
Oh, yeah.
Chicago.
How are we doing, Mr.
Chicago in the house.
Hey, Santa, hey. Gotta say hi to
yeah.
Shout out to all of our A1 Day One extended family. Linda Weller. Hi, everyone from England.
All right.
XX, that's kiss, kiss.
Yeah.
Hug.
Kiss, kiss.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any questions out there?
That's what I'm looking for. Folks, okay. Get your questions in while you have these guys right here with you.
That's right. That's right.
Anything about their music career? Shout out to Linda Lane, Melissa Lewandowski.
Shout out to Tassie Hawthorne.
Oh, Tassie Hawthorne. Marissa Lucas.
Wow.
John Page in the house.
Yeah, that's our sax player right there. He's in the horn section.
Yeah,
writes all the horn. Writes, he and Ken get together and write all the horn parts for our arrangement.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Shout out to my sister Faith. My family in Sherrill, South Carolina.
Hey.
Wow.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. Okay, we got him back.
Oh, got the mail back? Okay.
Yeah, got him back. Bonnie Cox.
Okay. Hey, Bonnie.
Great show,
your sister Jackie is on.
Uh-oh. Hey, Jackie.
Del my Fonic sister Jackie. Moore.
Yeah, Jackie Moore, right?
Yeah, that's my sister. Yeah. Uh-huh. Detroit.
Kate Hadel. Kate Hadel is on. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I see.
Just give you guys a few shout-outs. I don't see any questions though. Kathy Laredo.
There's one.
Okay, what we got? Oh, you want to take the kid?
What's the difference between music now and then?
Now, music then was music, but now.
Okay.
No insult to no one, but a lot of things that's happening now is mostly production.
Right.
Yeah.
And you got a lot of singers who where they were, I think there were great songs back in the day, but now you have a lot of singers who try to oversing to make a song sound like it's better than what it is, but I think, to me, that's just my opinion. I feel like back then music and arrangements made the song. There were some great performers as well. But now you got singers who try to, I think they oversing to try to convince you that it's a great song.
But
it's mostly production work now. So back then there were real musicians. Guys went in the studio with instruments and drums, and singers had to sing. And now you got machines that kind of can make a person sound like they sing. And a lot of singers now, almost they sound alike. It's hard to really tell the difference.
That's true. That's true. Yeah.
But that's just my humble opinion.
Uh-huh. Okay. That answers that.
Okay.
That was the same question. Okay.
Yeah. All right. From Jassy.
Hey, they actually
You got it, Shelly?
Okay, right. Yeah. This is from Tassie Hawthorne, our regular, who's on every week. Are there groups you mesh with you would love to do a concert with?
Wow.
Sure. I got this.
Oh, you got that. You got would it. Be the Godfather Brothers.
You know, the boy.
Shylights.
To do a show, Johnny Carlos.
But we gotta, we gotta have one at a time. So we can hear you.
Hey.
One at a time, so we can, hear you guys. I'm sorry. Who wants to answer?
Go ahead, Joe.
You got it, Ekev?
Sure.
Shylights.
Yeah, I was just
Oh, okay. Yeah, we just had Marshall on was it a couple weeks ago?
Yeah.
I seen it. It was wonderful. Wonderful.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Thank you.
Lovely.
Thank
you. That would be awesome.
Anybody else?
Well, actually, I was gonna say that Dean took the words out of my mouth, but you know, with Marshall Thompson and the Shylights.
Uh-huh.
We pretty much, you know, because of the pandemic, you know, we pretty much were, I thought it was set in stone. We were getting ready to do something, you know, but unfortunately, because of the pandemic, you know, we're all just sitting back and waiting, you know, ready to come out the gate.
Yes.
Indeed. Somebody's asking for a tune. I know it's hard to sync up vocal harmonies virtually. I don't know what you guys want to do. I must say first, though, folks, you're doing this virtually. It's sometimes there's a little delay, so
there you go. Hey, all right.
If I lose your love, come on, don't get me.
Go ahead, Val. Is it true that you're leaving?
There you go.
Leaving me for someone else. Go ahead, Val.
If it's true, what will I do in this lonely, mixed up world by myself? You told me one thing.
That's where you're
gonna lose it.
Yeah, that's
all right. You know, sometimes we fiend so much just to perform, and
oh, for sure.
And you know, we get excited, you know, and so just to be able to sing, because I'm a church singer too, and this we're not having church service either, so.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. I'm trying to hold back because you're telling me.
Yeah, you got to let it out.
I want to do it, but
yeah, I understand.
We have one last question, and this is for James. This is from Debbie McFadders. Go ahead, Debbie.
Oh, Debbie.
Hi. Oh yeah.
This is Debbie McFadders.
How are you doing, Dave?
Love that you have shown Clyde.
Well, thank you so much. Well, hey, he is inspiration for the Detroit Animals and everyone that came from that era. We learned so much about business as well as the love for the business, and don't have the business take care of business on you. Clyde McFadden taught us some wonderful things.
That's right.
He was the gentleman that really could sing and do it all. And it's just a wonderful thing to have a chance to speak to you. Yes.
That's all right, awesome. Debbie. Beautiful.
So, hey, beautiful. Mr. Max.
All right.
Have a good night.
All right, thank you.
Good night.
All right. Thank you, Dad.
Good night.
There it is.
Well, all right. So that's going to wrap up the Shining Stars section. Thank you guys so much for your comments and your questions and your participation.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In the meantime, I'm trying to find something I can throw up on the stage on there. So.
Watch out. Hey, please make sure they have a note on. Let's go up there. Says, this is for Eddie. This is for Eddie. It has to say, this is for Eddie.
Yes, indeed.
Well, right now, we'd like to announce next week's great guest. We're going to have songwriter, songwriter, Motown producer, and he writes for so many artists. You're going to say, what? He wrote that too? And the amazing, legendary Jimmy Roach. Oh, and there he is. Yes.
Lock. No Saints Lock.
You don't want to miss that.
Lock, don't say anything, Lock.
<Uh-oh>.
Yeah.
Okay, after the show.
That, yeah, that used to be a Lock's manager. Jimmy Roach is the one that brought Lock into the music business. Yes, he did.
Nice.
Is that right?
Hey, it's a small world. We're connected in some kind of way.
Separation. Yeah, absolutely.
That's right. That's right.
Come on.
But, but he's a great writer. He's a great singer, a string arranger. I mean, the best in the business that was doing it at debutante time.
Okay, great, great.
Legends. We also want to thank all of you for your love and support on our website, Celebrity Shoutouts. Mm-hmm. And that's when you guys click on the link, choose a celebrity, and tell us what you'd like to tell a loved one of yours. You know, Valentine's Day is coming up. We can either send a loving message to a loved one, or if you want to break up with someone, don't do it on Valentine's Day. But in any event, we have a little video of celebrity shout outs, and we'll be right back.
Right back.
All right.
Hey everybody, this is Verdeen White of Earth, Wind, and Fire. And
hi, this is Martha Davis from The Motels, and I just wanted to let you know that I am now on Celebrity Shoutouts.
Hey everybody, it's Shelly Clark, formerly of the iCats and original member of The Honeycomb.
Hi everyone, Ken Knox here from Chairman of the Board.
Hey, this is Rob Johnson from Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Hey everybody, this is Stuart Baskin with Black Ivory. And it is my pleasure to come to you on behalf of Celebrity Shoutouts.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Jerry Midas Hardison here representing the chairman of the board as well as the executives.
We are proud to be part of Celebrity Shoutout.
Whether you need birthdays, anniversaries, a special occasion, or you want us to shout out to a friend, contact Celebrity Shoutouts.
Yeah, make sure you go over to Celebrity Shoutouts and browse around.
Get
a shout out. Old girl from the motels. That was nice.
Martha.
Yeah, she was from the motels.
She was on a few episodes ago. That was the first one of the year, if I'm not mistaken.
Might have been.
Yeah, because after New Year's. Okay, all right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we the co-hosts of That's My Story would like to remind you that we just launched our Patreon page. And if you aren't familiar with Patreon, it's an easy way for those that are interested in our show to help us by contributing in a way that allows us to bring more content and guests to the show. We never imagined the show would grow to the success that it has. And even though we truly love doing this, it comes with a lot of behind the scenes work and expense. So if you can see here, by contributing as little as $10 per month, patrons will enable us to dedicate more time to creating by helping cover the many costs incurred from our work. In exchange, we have many goodies that will be only available exclusively to our Patreons.
That's
and great. We understand if you're not in a position to become one of our patrons at this time, No worries at all. You can still tune in each week and join us. We love and appreciate everyone that has been there for us, because without you all, none of this would be possible. So we thank you so much for your support. There's the link right there, folks. Patreon.com/thatsmystory2021. Go over there, take a look around, and look at those goodie bags that come along with your membership. And we greatly appreciate you all.
You're gonna love it. You're gonna love it.
Oh, yeah.
Indeed.
I want to let the audience know that we want to thank Ecuador U.S. Roses, which are the world's most beautiful roses. Last week, Shelly and our producer Taz received some of these roses.
Yes, they did.
We have these roses as well. So keep listening, and we'll tell you how you can have a chance to win these roses for yourself. So if you'd like to order these, go to the website. Look at all of the stunning choices they have to offer. There's a link right there. Mm-hmm. And they even have roses that will live up to a year.
Yeah.
Wow.
And fellas, Valentine's Day is right around the corner, so get your orders in now.
Yep.
And the cutoff date for that is February the 8th by 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So, guys on the panel, Get your roses.
Yes, indeed. Also, folks, every week we will be doing a drawing from all of our Patreons, and the winner will receive two dozen of these beautiful Ecuador USA roses, the world's most beautiful roses. So are we ready to find out who the winner is for this week's drawing?
Oh, yes.
Let me see if I get a drum roll going here. Yeah. You guys want to help me get a little drum roll? So Taz did the drawing before the show.
Rock, give me a drum roll, Rock.
And we don't know who the winner is, so she's going to pop it up here just a moment.
Shout out to
Miss Simple.
Yeah, Kimberly Bowman.
Okay, shout out to Miss Kimberly Bowman. You are the winner of this week's two dozen roses from U.S. Ecuador USA roses.
The
world's most beautiful roses, man. Those are lovely. Shout out to Kim.
Yeah.
All right. Oh, and one other thing. We have been encouraging you guys to jump on board with us with the Just Wear the Mask campaign. You know, we are in a pandemic, and we just like to use our platform to spread awareness. So we encourage you guys, when you're going out in public into places that may be slightly crowded, throw your mask on and protect others as well as protect yourself. And can y'all see what we did right there? Y'all see that?
Yeah, Bernie.
Bernie. You know, that's been going around on the internet like crazy, so we had to hop on board too. And folks on Facebook, if you take a picture of yourself wearing your mask, and hashtag just wear the mask, and tag us in your just wear the mask photo. We really appreciate it.
All right.
There you go, Lavelle. And we want to, before we get out of here, we want to remind everyone to make sure you go over to our YouTube page. This episode 38. So you guys should definitely have made it over to the YouTube page by now. There it is at the bottom of the screen. Make sure you like and subscribe. And every time we upload new content, it'll come directly to your homepage. I've subscribed, and every week I get the video right there.
Oh yeah,
right there.
That's how I can help share the replay afterwards. I don't have to go typing in anything.
it comes right
there to my homepage. You know. So before we get out of here, we want to thank our guests for today for coming. Stopping by and hanging out with us. We got E-Kim, James Mitchell Jr., Dwayne Locke Lomax, Lavelle Jackson, the James Mitchell Detroit Emeralds. The legacy continues. We appreciate you guys so much for your time. It's been a pleasure. It's been a party.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys. Love you guys.
Thank you. Love. Much love to you all. Ken.
I want to say something. I hadn't seen James. I also played with the Detroit Emeralds way back in the day.
Uh-huh.
It's the first time I've seen James in probably 50 years. Yes.
Awesome.
Good to see you, man. The same here. And I'm so good to meet Lavelle and E-Cam.
Pleasure.
And you guys are keeping the legacy alive, and my hat's off to you.
Yes.
Thank right. you, sir.
Yeah. Shelly, have anything you'd like to say before we hop off here for the evening?
Yeah, Verdeen is so fascinated with this show. He's watching on another computer somewhere.
Okay.
Hello, there. Hello.
Hey, my God. Energy, Mr. Energy, boy. Yeah. I love him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Boy, I'm feeling so. He says,
he moves so much. I think the stage moving when I see him. I said, he moves.
He can move.
The stage
yes.
moving when I
yes.
see him.
Yes,
right?
Hey, he can move, boy.
Imagine life in a pandemic with him.
Yes, yes. Gotta love it.
Oh, there we go.
We're all the wise.
It, they can't
wise
help it.
They go back.
They can't help it.
That's great. All right, so guys, we want to remind yeah. y'all to our guests, we want to just remind you to stay on the screen after we run the credits so we can say goodbye to you privately yeah. before we part ways and get some dinner and things like that this evening.
Yeah.
All right, folks. Well, folks at home wow. out there in internet land, thank you once again for joining us. We'll see you next week for episode 39 with Mr. Jimmy Roach. We bid you Godspeed and blessings. Until then, you guys stay safe. Stay out the way of the pandemic. Follow the rules of this. Don't be going a lot of places. Hands washed and sanitized. We see you, Lavelle.
Right,
we're gonna say
right,
good night. God right. bless you all. We'll see you next week for episode 39. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.